Good morning and welcome to Fairhaven Church of Ridgetown on a beautiful Sunday communion morning. Today is communion, and so Sunday communion today services, I'm sorry, youth will not meet today in the back, but children's services will continue as normal. Giving tree, it's in the works, it's happening. We saw some folks this morning already bringing some stuff in, and there's still quite a few tags left to be picked if you're able to, when it's on your heart. Pastor Vince Montempi is going to give us a quick demo on how this works. So if you would, turn your attention to Vince.
Take a tag, buy a gift, bring it back, unwrap, with the tag, and at the top, whatever little Jimmy's on there, iPad is on there. Make sure that you put your gift with the tag in the corresponding tote. So, like this one has a little bear on it, the little bear's over there. So you just put it in there, all right? If you got questions, see Audrey. If you have questions, see me. Also, another thing that came up, let's say you really want to help out with this, but you really don't want to shop. It's okay if you pull a tag and then say, I want to buy this and give whatever you have with it to Audrey or to myself, and we'll get it for you, okay? Or if you just want to give a donation towards it, you can do that also. But we are requesting that everything be turned in by Sunday the 18th, so that we can get everything dropped off before Christmas. All right?
Awesome. Thank you. And so with that, holiday services schedule, as a reminder, Christmas Eve service will be this year on Christmas Eve at 4 p.m. Christmas Day service will be at 11 a.m. No classes on that day. And then New Year's Day service, I think that might be new this year, maybe not, will be at 11 a.m. Also, no classes. For any of the regular upcoming events, we have the men's prayer breakfast for you, those of you that are joining us over at Cracker Barrel at 7 a.m. on the 11th. And then on December 18th, we have the Children's Christmas Program and our monthly fellowship dinner. So sign-up sheets are out front if you want to bring something in for that fellowship dinner. On Christmas Eve also, the service at 4 p.m. will be held for about an hour and a half or so. Somewhere, not quite even that long, I'm being told. No, about an hour. Okay. Awesome. So Christmas Eve, 4 p.m. this year. Youth events, reminder, no youth group this evening will not meet. And then on December 11th, we're going to head down to Massillon, I think it is, right, for the live nativity scene this year. We'll meet right here at 4:45 on the 11th and then head down from there. If you have any questions about details on that, just check out the Facebook page and click on the little events link there. You'll find it. On December 18th, we have the gingerbread contest that will be right here, and it'll be it won't be here. It'll be at Graham's house.
Graham's house.
It says at church, and we'll have to correct that for next week. But at Graham's house, apparently. And karaoke with that also, yes. So it'll be fun. What else we got? Prayer needs, prayer updates, news from the Kelsey family on Joey. It sounds like she's going to return home.
She's coming home tonight. And then we just have to wait about three more weeks for the blood clot to dissolve so they can shock her heart back.
Yeah. It's good to see Bill back in the church, so glad you're feeling better and back able to get back here.
Yes.
So welcome. Speaking of Bill Decker is getting ready to have surgery, I think next week is what I heard. Yep. So be in prayer for him. And then the Haas family recovering from COVID this week. So keep them in your prayers as well. And then news from the Bennett family for you guys. Please keep Mr. Combs in your prayers as he fell and broke his arm. How's he doing?
Not real good.
Yeah. Sure. Okay. Thank you for sharing that. We will. A reminder, well, just before I move on, are there any new prayer requests or thoughts? Yes.
I have two. The Bill White family, Bill passed away on Friday night. So if you remember his family in prayer. And then Beth is having knee replacement surgery on the 7th, my sister right here.
My sister Beth, right here.
And then pray for me and Amy, because she's coming to my house after surgery, so I have to take care of two babies.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, the hospital. Goodness.
We should pray.
We'll do.
We should pray for Jay also.
Jay?
We should pray for Jay.
Why?
Just because.
I'll stay away.
Any new other prayer requests? Maybe real quick? Nope. Okay. Yep.
Jeff wanted to request a prayer for his mom, who's having bad surgery in a couple weeks. Donna Camperla.
What's her name?
Della.
Donna.
Della.
Della.
D-E-L-L-A.
Della.
Della. Okay. Will do. Thank you. Yeah. How about, oh, in the back.
Tomorrow is my grandma's annual bladder cancer check. She has been cancer-free for, I think, 2 years now, so we always kind of hold our breath every year that she gets her new scan. That's tomorrow morning.
Okay. And what's your mom's name?
My grandma, Viola. Bye.
Viola?
Yep.
All right, we'll do. Thank you very much.
Viv.
Thank you. Anything else? How about praises? Any God moments that anyone experienced this week, or moments where you can share the gospel with someone? We have a new visitor coming in front. Good morning. Good
morning. That's his God moment.
That is a God moment right there. How about that? Hey.
Hello. December 8th on Thursday at 7:30, if you guys would like to see a lot of God moments and a lot of fun stuff, like a State Gospel Choir is this Thursday concert. It's really fun.
That's true.
You should come. It's really fun.
That's at Kent State.
Yeah. It's
where at?
Cartwright Hall.
What time?
7:30.
Thursday, 7:30, Cartwright Hall, Kent State University.
And let me tell, I will add this. If you go to this gospel concert, wear comfortable shoes.
Yeah.
Because this is like full on knee slapping, toe tapping, full extension gospel choir. All right, that is really fun. It's really fun.
It's a really good time. And like the director, he is a worship leader at a church in Cleveland, and seriously, some of the best musicians I've ever worked with, and it's just all around really fun. So if you guys want to see some like fun worship stuff,
very cool. Well, a reminder that we have two services on Sundays, 8:30 and 11 a.m., and junior church is offered for little kids in foundation class for junior and senior high school. That being said, we have a birthday girl here with us today, or tomorrow will be her official birthday. We'd love to have you all join us in a quick birthday to 14-year-old Lucy Maltempe. Have a birthday. So if you would please join us in song.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Gio. Happy birthday to you.
Very cool. Happy birthday, Lucy. Just as John was preparing people 2,000 years ago for the first Advent, we can use the example of John's ministry and his words of preparation for the second Advent, also known as the second coming of Jesus. We would invite you to open your Bibles as we prepare to read and listen to Pastor Bennett as he explains Luke chapter 3, verses 1 through 6, the ministry of John the Baptist. Just before we do that, brothers and sisters, it's a great day to be in the house of the Lord, and we'll open our worship services now. Thank you.
Please stand and turn your hymnals to page 181.
Mark the Lord and our only
Brothers and sisters, let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all of your blessings this day. Thank you for the ability to gather together as brothers and sisters in the faith. Gathered here as your family, Lord, to give glory and honor to you, to worship you. Lord, we ask you humbly that you forgive us of our sins. Wipe us clean. Let us stand worthy in your presence because of your blood, because of your sacrifice. Strengthen us, Lord. Help us in our weakness and help us in our sickness to follow you, to be close to you, Lord. Lift up to you so many prayer requests, Lord. We continue to pray for Joey as she makes her way home. Pray that this goes easily, Lord God. We pray for Beth and her surgery coming up this week. Pray for Bill and his surgery coming up this week. That you would be with them and be with their doctors. Let them have good recoveries. Lift up to you, Della. Lift up to you, Mr. Combs. Pray that you would watch out for them and be with them and continue to heal them. Lord, we pray for the Haas family and for their sickness. And pray that you help them get over it. Lord, we pray for continued good news for Graham and that tomorrow goes well. Lord, we lift up to you all of the other prayers that we have in our hearts that have gone unspoken. Lord, that you would watch over them and hold them. Lord, we pray for the families that we're helping with this giving tree. We pray that through some small gift, that through some word of grace, Lord, that you would be able to touch them, that you would be able to get a hold of them. You would give them the greatest gift that anyone can get, which is receiving you. Pray for our church, Lord, for our members. We pray for our community. We pray, Lord, that you give us the strength to fulfill our mission of sharing the gospel, of being a light in the darkness, of being a place where people can come and learn about Jesus, and help us to that end. Lord, we're thankful for the gifts that we receive today, that they're given from hearts, cheerfulness and generosity, knowing that all things come from you, Lord, and all things return to you. Jesus, we love you. Be with us always. We ask for this in your name. Amen.
Please stand. Our next song is on the handout.
Let faith arise.
You may be seated. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for the beautiful sunshine that you've given us today. And Lord, I just thank you that we can all come together to celebrate this upcoming season of your birth and time for us to remember. Lord, I pray that you'd be with all the people who are sick. There's a lot of sickness going on right now. And pray that you'd touch those people. Lord, pray that you'd be with Pastor Vince this morning as he delivers his message. And I pray that you would have our minds clear and open to hear what he has to say. And we pray all these things in your name. Amen.
So this week, as we move into the second week of Advent, here in the Advent season, we're going to be looking at Luke chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. We're going to be spending a lot of time talking about John the Baptist. A lot of time talking about John the Baptist. And I'll tell you, for a long time, you know, you go through it, you always say, you know, I feel more, oh yeah, if the little kids want to go back, Sean's going back. So if there are any of them are still here, you know, for a long time, you sit there and you say, boy, you know, I really like Paul. I really like Peter. I can see myself in this. I can see myself in that. John the Baptist is one man. I really, really like the ministry of John the Baptist. We're going to be touching on that now. This is the second week of Advent, like we said. And I want to make sure that we hit on it. I don't know that we hit it specifically last week. But when we talk about Advent, we talk about Advent in two ways, right? 2,000 years ago, Advent was showing the people to be ready for the coming of Jesus into the world, right? From the birth, for Emmanuel, for God with us. We celebrate Advent today not only as a remembrance of Jesus coming into the world 2,000 years ago, but we celebrate Advent with the hopeful expectation of Jesus' return. At some point, that's going to happen. That's the dual meaning of Advent. Advent then, Jesus coming into the world, and Advent today, Jesus coming back for his own. So we're going to be in chapter 3 of Luke. If you have your Bibles, we're going to read verses 1 through 6. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, Herod the Tetrarch of Galilee, his brother Philip, Tetrarch of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Lysanias, Tetrarch of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the country around the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight his paths. Every valley shall be filled, every mountain shall be made low. The crooked roads shall become straight, the rough ways smooth, and all people will see God's salvation. Let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Lord, fill this place. Fill this place with the Holy Spirit, Lord. Fill our hearts with the Holy Spirit to make us tender to the leading of your word. Fill our ears and our minds with the Holy Spirit and make us attentive to your word, that we may learn your word, that we may love your word, that we may live your word. And we ask for this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Is anyone having a hard time hearing me this morning? I had to turn it up a couple of times. Good? All right. You know, everyone, if we think about it, every one of us has certain expectations at Christmas time. Every one of us has certain expectations during the season of Advent. We expect to give gifts, and we expect to receive gifts. We expect the lights and the colors and the sights and the sounds of the season. We expect to eat a lot. And we expect to eat special foods and special cookies that we only get at Christmas time, right? We expect long lines at department stores. We expect to struggle finding parking spots, which I assume that those inconveniences combined with the pandemic for the last couple of years has what's completely blown up online shopping, right? We love online shopping because you can avoid the lines, you can avoid parking, you can pick something up or have it delivered to your office or your home or anywhere else. We have become such online shopping people at our
house, that last night I ran out of cough medicine and Lori had one bottle of cough medicine delivered to my house last night at 9:20. Like, how great is that, right? How great is that? So convenient. We expect to have our calendars packed during this time of year, to be rushing from one event to the other, from one party to the next, from one school concert to another church social. We expect to see our family. We expect to see our friends. Brothers and sisters, understand that there is much about the Christmas season that is to be expected. But what we really don't like during this time of year, and we heard a little bit about it actually this morning during our prayer time, we don't like the twists and turns of life that are unexpected that come our way during this time of year. These unexpected twists cause us stress and anxiety. We have enough of that already in our life. You know what I'm talking about here. Those unexpected twists, like the sudden loss of a job, or an unexpected death of a loved one, or an unexpected illness, or as I was seeing from so many of my friends who live on the west side over the last couple of days, trees that have come down, taken out power lines, and taken out parts of their houses because of all the wind that was going on farther on the west side. And my one buddy put, this is just what I needed 3 weeks before Christmas, right? These are the things that stress us out. An unexpected house guest, who knows? But each of those things is stressful enough. But when you add that to the stress and anxiety of the holiday, it's compounded. And sometimes it's compounded exponentially. We expect to, when we come to church during the Christmas season, that we're going to hear Christmas songs being sung like we did today, right? We expect that we're going to hear about the Christmas story. And you might find it a little unexpected that here, the second week of Advent, rather than going right to the Nativity story, we're going to talk about John the Baptist. We need to consider, though, brothers and sisters, that God did some really unexpected things during that first Christmas. It was unexpected that he came into the world as a completely helpless infant. God has always done the unexpected, and John the Baptist is an excellent example of that. And besides that, this Advent, what I really want to remind us is that Advent is a time to prepare with eager expectation for the coming of Jesus. And John the Baptist was sent by God to prepare for the coming of Jesus. God used an unexpected time and an unexpected person and an unexpected message, at least by human levels of expectation, to speak his revelation into reality. Personally, I think that John is the greatest role model for a minister ever. I know some people who say, man, I want to be like Paul. I want to be like Peter. But you know what? Being like John is really all that's expected. Because John had a mission that he was given by God. John fulfilled that message to the T. And because of that, he was considered a weirdo. He had no friends. He was put into jail and his head was cut off. But Jesus loved him. And he was considered great in the kingdom. And that's what we need to understand. The first two chapters of Luke, which we'll be looking at more in the coming weeks, the first two chapters of Luke Gospel deals with the birth narratives of both John the Baptist and Jesus. And throughout those two chapters, Luke intentionally sets John and Jesus together side by side. We're learning about both side by side through those chapters. As chapter 3 of Luke's gospel opens, Luke continues to set John and Jesus side by side as he's describing the beginning of their public ministries. But after this, except for one brief incident in Luke chapter 7, John disappears from the gospel. John is no longer seen in the gospel. And you can see that even Luke was cognizant of the fact that now that Jesus was here, Jesus takes center stage, right? Jesus is what the world needed. John was there to announce him, But here in chapter 3, they're still connected. They're still connected side by side. Let's give a little bit of background before this time that came for them. For the 30 or so years that John and Jesus had lived in private, out of the public eye, no one really knows a lot about that time. In fact, a lot of people say that, like, when I get to heaven, I'm going to ask Noah how he built the ark, right? Or I'm going to ask whoever. I want to ask John and Jesus, or maybe John. But I want to, like, during those 30 years, you guys were cousins. Obviously, we talked. Like, did they ever sit around after dinner when everyone was playing cards and be like, all right, man, so how's this going to work? Like, you're going to start, then I'm going to start. I'm just so curious how that conversation went, right? How did that go? But John, it says in chapter 1, that he lived in the wilderness until the day of his public appearance to Israel. And after his brief public appearance, at the age of 12 at the temple in Jerusalem, Jesus lived his life in the small, isolated village of Nazareth, where in chapter 2 of Luke, it says that he was submissive to his parents. So Jesus wasn't, you know, he wasn't a smart aleck. He wasn't like, you know how like everyone knows that kid who was like really bad when they were a kid, and then they grow up and like they're the cop, and you're like, of all the people, you're the one who ended up becoming a policeman, right? Jesus was submissive to his parents. He listened to his parents as he grew up in Nazareth. Very few people during these 30 years knew the true identities of John or Jesus. And of those few that knew, you had Elizabeth and Zechariah, John's mom and dad. You had Simeon and Anna, the two, I don't know if you want to call them prophets, but the two prayers in the temple who knew when they saw Jesus. And then you had Joseph, Jesus's dad. But by this point, the likelihood is that they all died because they're never mentioned again. They're never brought up. Only Mary of this group is ever mentioned again after this point. For these 30 years, there was no more mention or any word from the angels that made the announcement to John's family or to Jesus, to Mary. But the 30 years of silence was about to end. Just as the beginning of the ministry of John the Baptist would end an even longer period of silence. The period of silence of 400 years since God last spoke to his people through the prophet Malachi in around the year 430 BC. God, at that point, through Malachi, promised to send a deliverer called the Messiah, the Anointed One, would come to rescue his people. It says in chapter 3, verse 1. Moreover, God also promised that he would send a messenger who would prepare the way for the Messiah. Jesus, of course, we know, was the Messiah. And John, we know now, was the messenger. He was the preparer of the way. It's important to keep in mind that as John and Jesus were about to begin their ministries, Israel was suffering under incredible political and spiritual oppression. And really, folks, if you feel depressed over like what you hear on MSNBC or Fox or CNN, over like how badly divided we are, over how horrible everything is, spend some time reading what was going on in the Roman Empire and the countries that they had under subjugation during this time. We really don't have much to complain about, okay? Things were really bad. Really, really, really bad back then. It was a horrible time. Israel was under oppression. God's chosen people were under the repressive political and military rule of the Roman Empire. Furthermore, Israel's spiritual leaders, who should have been watching out for God's chosen people, they were corrupt and they were wicked. They were just as wicked as the Romans were. There was widespread ignorance of the scriptures, and there was apostasy. Everybody was falling away. The people were longing for political and military freedom, which is what they were hoping for when the Messiah would come. It was into this setting, it was into that environment that the messenger of God, John the Baptist, the first prophet in more than 400 years, appears and starts introducing the arrival of the Messiah. John's task was to prepare the people for the arrival of Jesus and to present him to the people. It's only a few verses that we read. Let's hit them. Let's read them again real quick just before we start pulling them all apart. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate being governor of Judea, Herod being tetrarch of Galilee, his brother Philip, tetrarch of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Lysanias, tetrarch of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. And he went into the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of the prophet Isaiah, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall become straight, and the rough places shall become level ways, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. I'm going to tell a story here that I know I've shared the story before many times, but it's such a good story, and it fits in here, so I'm going to include it. But early on in the 18th century, 19th century United States, there was this famous evangelist, and his name was Peter Cartwright. The claim to fame that Peter Cartwright had was that over the course of his ministry, he personally baptized over 12,000 converts, over 12,000 baptisms over the course of his ministry. He was known as a powerful, fiery, and uncompromising preacher of the word. Well, there's a story that one day when he was out somewhere preaching, the President of the United States, Andrew Jackson, came to hear Peter Cartwright talk. And he was told by some of his, I don't know, people around him, you know, whatever, he was told, hey, listen, the President is here. So don't say anything out of line, and don't say anything that might offend the president. He just nodded his head, said okay. So when he got up there to preach, this was the very first recorded word that came out when he started preaching. He said, I understand that President Andrew Jackson is here in attendance this morning, and I have been requested to be very guarded in my remarks. So I will only say this. Andrew Jackson will go to hell if he does not repent of his sin. And everybody's like, what? You know, everyone's jaw dropped. You can audibly hear it says the gasping of the crowd. How could he possibly say that? But he never backed down. He never backed down. After the service, it said that President Jackson made his way to Peter Cartwright, said, I need to shake his hand. And as he shook his hand, it's recorded that he said, sir, if I had a regiment of men like you, I could conquer the entire world. Brothers and sisters, like Peter Cartwright, John the Baptist was not afraid to confront people with the truth. In fact, a biblical commentator refers to John as a person who cared enough to confront. So we examine the ministry of John the Baptist, I think it will show us what constitutes a truly faithful ministry, right? What constitutes a truly faithful ministry? First, let's look at the context of this faithful ministry. Luke begins chapter 3 by listing off 7 leaders, 5 political leaders, and 2 spiritual leaders. And please note that when a name is listed in the Bible, it's not in there just to fill. You know, it's not like me at school where I've got to hit like 300 words. So I'm like, all right, let me come up with like 5 more words because I got to get to 300, right? There's a reason why these names are listed in there. And Luke lists 7, 5 political leaders and 2 spiritual leaders. And I think he does this to provide us with the historical context of this faithful ministry that John the Baptist had. First, Luke said that John began his ministry in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar. So Tiberius Caesar was the successor of Caesar Augustus. And Luke mentioned Caesar Augustus when he wrote in chapter 2 that Caesar Augustus made the decree that all of the world should be registered for a census. That's what ended up sending Jesus to Bethlehem, or that's why Jesus was born in Bethlehem, because Mary and Joseph had to go and register in Bethlehem for the census. In 11 AD, Tiberius became co-emperor with Augustus. And when Augustus died in August of 14 AD, Tiberius became the sole emperor of the Roman Empire. Some say that the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius would therefore mean that John's ministry began right around the year 29 AD. That, which is kind of cool if you think about the fact that we can pinpoint stuff like that because of the information that Luke wrote for us, right? Then we have Pontius Pilate, who was the fifth governor of Judea. Tiberius appointed Pontius Pilate in 26 AD, the same year that John began his ministry. Pilate, before whom Jesus appeared on the day of his crucifixion, is described throughout Scripture as a proud, arrogant, cynical, weak, and vacillating individual. And that's what we see. Next, Luke mentioned Herod the Tetrarch of Galilee. Herod was one of the six sons of Herod the Great. The Herod that's mentioned in this verse is Herod Antipas, who ruled Galilee after the death of his father Herod the Great, from 4 BC till 39 AD. He's also the Herod that's referred to in the rest of the gospel ministries of Jesus and John. He is the Herod that had John imprisoned and had John executed. And he's also the Herod that's mentioned in the sham court proceeding that convicted Jesus the night before that he was crucified. Luke then also mentions Herod's brother Philip, who was the tetrarch of Iturea and Trachonitis, which is just north of Galilee. And he also mentions Lysanias, the Tetrarch of Abilene. The interesting thing there is that many scholars for hundreds of years thought that Luke made a mistake because no evidence of a Lysanias was found. Except about 200 or so years ago, inscriptions were dug up somewhere of a Lysanias who was a Tetrarch, just as Luke had written, which ended up proving Luke true, which is really kind of neat. Finally, Luke said that John began his ministry during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas. Here's what's interesting about this. In Judaism, there was only ever one high priest. There's never two at the same time. There was only ever one. So why does Luke mention both Annas and Caiaphas? Well, in those days, the high priest was both a civil and a religious leader. And previously, the office of the high priest had been hereditary, and it had been for life. But with the coming of the Romans, the office became the object of all sorts of political intrigue, right? The result, from the time of the Roman occupation, between 37 BC and 26 AD, a span of 63 years, there were no fewer than 28 different high priests. Annas was actually the high priest from 6 to 15 AD. So by this point, he was out of office. But here's what's interesting. Following Annas, four of his sons, and now Caiaphas, who was his son-in-law, were the following high priests. And in fact, Annas is the first person that Jesus is brought to for the court, instead of Caiaphas, who was the high priest at the time. And I think what Luke was showing us here, that even though Caiaphas had the title of high priest, Annas was the power broker in the temple, right? So Caiaphas had the title, but Annas was really the power broker. What Luke is doing here, more than providing the accurate historical context for the ministry, he's trying to show us what a mess of political and spiritual conditions John had to deal with. Think about this. So right now, the U.S. has struggles with one president. What if we had four, right? And none of them got along. And then what happens? I mean, four at the same time, right? And then combine the fact that they were in cahoots with the leaders of the temple. It was a mess that John was getting into the middle to. The outlook was bleak and dismal by human standards. How could anyone hope to successfully minister in this kind of environment? But that's what God sent John into. And it's an indication of a faithful ministry and a faithful minister. Every faithful minister is set apart to minister in the historical and the cultural context that God gives. Whether that ministry is in Israel, whether it's in China today, or North Korea, or Thailand, or the Middle East, or anywhere else, wherever it looks darkest, wherever it looks bleakest, that's where the light needs to go. And that's where the light needs to shine. Secondly, we need to notice the call to a faithful ministry. The mighty Roman Empire ruled the world in utter and complete rebellion against God. And the corrupt spiritual leaders of Israel misled God's covenant people through their misguided and false teachings. For more than 400 years, God remained silent. And during that time, there had not been a true prophet in Israel. But one day, the word of God came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. John received a call from God to the ministry, to preach, to baptize. And although the Bible doesn't tell us how the word came to John, nevertheless, he discerned it in his heart that God had called him into the ministry. Brothers and sisters, we learn that every faithful minister of the gospel receives an inward call from God. Prior to the start of the ministry, there must be an inward conviction that God has called them into the ministry. And then there's always an outward call, an affirmation of the gifts and abilities. I remember, it's one of those things where you don't just decide one day, I think I'm going to be a pastor. I think I'm going to be a missionary. That's a sure way for complete misery your whole life. That's not the way it works. You have a calling. You have a feeling, and it comes over time, and it takes a long time. I remember, man, I feel like time just flies by, but I remember 19 years ago now, I was reminiscing about it with Russ Bowman here. Those early days, when I just started out, I went to Emmaus, and God opened up my mind to all of his kingdom and what I could do. I came back and I felt like, Lord, you're going to serve me somewhere. I'm going to do something. And I went to church. I was going up to RUMC, and I got into this Bible study called Disciple, where we were reading through the Bible. And I remember I would tell Lori, I'm like, Lori, I don't know, man. I feel like God is stirring me to something. I didn't know what. I didn't like act on it right away. I didn't like sell everything. But I just started praying about it and waiting about it, seeing what I was going to do. And then one day, my buddy Chad comes up to me. We hadn't spoken about it at all. He says, Vince, have you ever thought about getting into the ministry? I said, Chad, that's so weird. I've been praying about this for like months. And that's how it started. Then I started by teaching a little junior high, middle school, Sunday school class. And that's what I knew. When I was with those kids, that's what I knew. And I'll tell you, sometimes I think I'm up here and I'm fooling all of you guys. Sometimes I still think in my heart that God only ever called me to be a youth pastor. I love those kids. I love being around them. I love teaching them. And I love all of you guys too, I'm not saying that. But I remember being with those kids and being a goofball and telling all of those weird stories and all of the weird kind of things that I'd experienced in my life and all of these weird interests and likes and hobbies that I have. And I remember one time I was sharing something with the kids. I don't remember what it was. I mean, this is going back like 13, 14 years. And Lori was just listening from the other room. And then she came in and she was like, you know, I always wondered why God had you do all of those weird things. And I think it's just so you can be good with the kids when you talk to them. But you just never know the path that God just kind of takes you about. You know, and that's how it happens. It comes through prayer. It comes through discernment. It comes through a long time, you know. John models this call to a ministry. Every faithful minister
must receive an inward call from God. And I'll say this too, the ministry's hard. The ministry's hard. And it's hard on the minister. It's hard on the family of the minister. And here's the funny thing about when you know it's a call from God. You can get down and depressed about the ministry. I'm thinking about so many conversations I have with Pastor Kelsey on this, forget about it. And other pastors too. You can get down about it, and you can be sad about it, and you can yell at God and say, God, why are you doing this to me? Why are you doing this to my family? But here's how you know when it's a call from God. That for all of those things, you could never imagine doing anything else. And you know that you would be miserable if you weren't fulfilling your call. That's when you know. I'm telling you, if you don't think that John had moments when he was sitting in Herod's prison, knowing that he was going to get his head chopped off, where he didn't think to himself even for a moment, you know, why didn't I just hang out with my dad? He was a high priest and had a good life going on. Why did I do this? But John knew that was his calling. That's being a faithful minister. That's having a faithful ministry. Third, we need to look at the purpose of a faithful ministry. Luke said after receiving his call to the ministry, John went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. It's helpful to keep in mind that John's baptism is not the same as the baptism that we know today. It was a foreshadowing. It was a type. It was a pointing forward to the baptism that we understand today, the baptism that was inaugurated after Jesus' death and resurrection. You see, John knew that in order to be reconciled with God, people needed to have their sins forgiven. And in order to receive the forgiveness for their sins, the people needed to repent. And what is repentance? Repentance is a change of direction. You're living and going this way, and now you say, you know what, Lord? I understand that I'm going the wrong way in my life. So I'm going to turn, and I'm going to walk that way. As long as that way is going towards Jesus. That's repentance. People need to stop sinning. They could receive forgiveness while still intending to carry on their sinful ways, and that's not right. There needed to be a complete abandonment from their wrong. When people expressed this wholehearted desire to abandon their wickedness, that's when John would baptize as a visual display of people turning from their sin, of being washed, of being cleansed. Know also that John was raised in an Essene community, and the Essenes were a sect of Jews that practiced ceremonial washing, ceremonial cleansing with water for purification. So this was a very normal thing for John to show. People say, I'm sorry, I'm turning. Okay, let me wash you. Let me make you clean. Let me make you whole. It was a symbolic version of that. Ultimately, John's preaching and baptism pointed to the coming of the Messiah, who was the only one through whom forgiveness of sins would come. In other words, and make sure we're clear on this, John's faithful ministry pointed people to Jesus, because Jesus is the only one who could give forgiveness. The only one. The purpose of all faithful ministry, even today, should be to point people to Jesus. If there's a ministry that's not pointing people to Jesus, then that is not a faithful ministry, period. Any ministry that doesn't point people to Jesus is a pointless ministry, and it's a fraud. Brothers and sisters, we need to always remember and always keep in mind that Jesus is the way, Jesus is the truth, Jesus is the life, and no one comes to God except through Jesus Christ. No other way, no other, there's no side, there's no exception, there's no, only through Jesus. And faithful ministers and faithful ministries proclaim the good news of the gospel, that grace, that salvation is a gift of God that comes alone through faith in Christ alone, period. There's no other way. And that's what John did. That's why I love John's word in the Bible. When Jesus showed up, what did John say? Now I must decrease,
so that he must increase, right? Finally, we observe the significance of a faithful ministry. Think about this. In the ancient world, it was customary. When kings were arriving, they would start sending people in advance to announce their coming, right? To make a big deal so they could be received with pomp and circumstances. Do any of you remember? I know that when I mention things now, I sound like I'm 100. I'm not. I watch things in rerun. But you remember, like on Looney Tunes, right? When they had the castle and the king was coming, the drawbridge would come down, and what would come out? You'd have two guys with the trumpets, you know, blowing the horn. They were heralding the arrival of the king, right? A message from the king, right? Like on Hamilton, a message from the king, right? Just get that, you know what I'm talking about. They were heralding the arrival of the king, right? That's what John was for Jesus. He was the herald of the king. And let's make sure that we know this, because I was stunned several years ago in youth group when they didn't know this. The song we sang today, Hark the Herald Angels Sing, right? Herald is describing what the angels were doing. They were heralding the arrival of Jesus, right? That wasn't like their name. Like, this wasn't like, oh, we need to call the herald angels. And no, we need the different angels to. They were heralding the arrival of Jesus. John was heralding the arrival of Jesus. He was preparing everyone. 700 years before the birth of Jesus, the prophet Isaiah took this custom of heralding and turned it into prophecy that one day a great king would come to God's people. And when he did come, a messenger would go ahead and announce the news of his coming. Luke then took that prophecy and applied it to Jesus and John. As it is written, Luke wrote, in the words of the prophet Isaiah, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, every mountain shall be made low. The crooked shall become straight, the rough places shall become level ways, and flesh shall see the salvation of God. Now understand, Isaiah wasn't telling everyone, and Luke's not telling everyone that the Lord is coming, therefore grab some shovels and start fixing the street, or get some picks and start lowering some of the mountains. He wasn't talking about physically preparing the way. He was talking about spiritually preparing the way. Spiritually preparing the way, right? If you've got a high place of pride in your heart, you need to level that to prepare a way for the Lord. If you've got a crooked road in your heart struggling with sin, you need to straighten that out to prepare your heart for the way of the Lord. And understand also that when Luke wrote that all flesh will see salvation, he's not saying that every single person in the human race is going to be saved. Even those who willfully reject Jesus, that would run counter to every basic doctrine of the New Testament. But what Luke is saying is this. He's not saying that everyone will be saved. He's saying that everyone can be saved. Everyone can be saved. There is no person, there is no place, there is no time, there is no region where a person can't be saved. And I've said this a million times, and I'll say it again. If someone ever says to you, if you're talking to someone, because I know you all, when you're out there in the world talking, you can't wait to tell people about Jesus, okay? If you're talking to someone, and you start talking about Jesus, and they give you the answer back, I'm way too far gone. I've already punched my ticket for hell. I'm not a violent person. You have my permission. You can tell me. Just, you don't have to hurt them. A little step on the foot or a kick in the shin just to get their attention. and then literally tell them that is absolute nonsense. It's absolute nonsense. And anyone that feels that they're too far gone to receive salvation is probably really, really close to being saved. Right? How do we sum all this up?
John the Baptist was a faithful minister. He served in a difficult historical context, but he was clearly called by God, and he pointed Jesus. He pointed people to Jesus. Two challenges that I want to give all of us today as we leave here. First, pray that God continues to raise godly men and women who will be faithful ministers of the good news of Jesus Christ to a failing and falling world. Pray for that. We need God to raise people like that. Not people who fake it, because eventually they'll fall away. Not people who do it because it's cool, because eventually they'll fall away too. But that God will truly raise faithful ministers of the word. And secondly, and this one's a little more personal, and it's for all of us. Are your hearts prepared? Are your hearts loved? And think about it this way. Are you truly willing to be led by Jesus? There's a lot of people that say, I want to follow Jesus. But they want to follow Jesus on their own terms. Right? There's a lot of people that say, I want to be taught by Jesus. But they don't really want to be taught something that they don't already know. They don't want to be taught something new. That's a condition of the heart that needs changed. You know, I can't believe it now even when I say it. When I combine it with my time back at Malone, I've been in some kind of seminary now for 7 years. And I can't tell you how many times in class, both in person and online, there's always a student who shows up to the class who was convinced that everything that they knew in the scripture was it, and that they were only there to get a document that approved of everything they knew, and how they would fight with the professor, and how they would fight with the students, and oftentimes they would drop out making dramatic statements like, I should have known I wouldn't get nothing good out of a seminary or whatever. But is your heart ready to learn? Is your heart ready to be led by Jesus? Because if it is, you may have your world rocked in a good way. In a good way. So let's be ready for that. So we're going to bow our heads. We're going to pray. We'll pray for the elements. And then we'll do communion afterwards. So let's bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Lord, be with us this day. And help us, Lord. Help us to not only be strong in you, help us to not only place our faith in you, but Lord, help us to prepare our heart for you. Help us to lower all of the rough spots and twisty spots in our heart to make us ready for you. Lord, help us to be teachable. Help us, Lord, to be leadable. Give us that in our hearts, Lord. Help us to be good followers of you. Lord, we pray for this, and we pray for the elements today, that you would bless and be with the bread and the cup that we have here this morning, that your Holy Spirit would be with them, that through the elements we experience a means of your grace as a reminder, Lord, of the sacrifice that you made on the cross. Jesus, we love you. Be with us always. And we ask for this in your precious name. Amen. On the night that Jesus was given up for death, a death that he freely accepted, he gathered with the apostles and with those he loved to celebrate the Passover meal. And he was looking forward to this meal with them. In the Gospel of Luke, it tells us that Jesus looked at them and said, I have eagerly looked forward to sharing this meal with you. And at a certain point in that meal, he took the bread, and he raised the bread to heaven, and he gave thanks to God for the bread. And then he broke the bread. He turned to those whom he loved, and he said, this is my body given for you. Do this, and when you do, remember me. Later in the meal, he took the cup. And again, he raised the cup to heaven. and he gave thanks to God for the cup. And then he turned to the apostles and he said, this is the cup of my blood, the blood of a new and everlasting covenant. It will be shed for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this, and when you do, remember me. To make homemade bread again and to cut it up for us. So as you come up, just take the bread here on this side, the cup on this side, here on this side, the cup on this side, and then go back to your seats. But sisters, the table is ready. Come forward as you're led.
You know what gray hair from?
I'm getting gray.
Yeah. Trying to be like me.
Yeah, you're my role model.
All right, let's bow our heads and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this gift that you've given us. When we eat this bread and when we drink this cup, Lord, we proclaim your glory. And as we celebrate this time, Lord, we lift up our voices to you. Together, as we pray the words that our Savior taught us, and we all pray together. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom. Power and the glory forever. Amen.
turning your hymnals to page 287.
For your coming. We love you and we ask for all this in your name. Amen.